JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for July the 14th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, head of research here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded higher against all but one of the other major currencies on Tuesday during the Asian morning Wednesday. It lost ground only against NZD, while it gained the most versus the euro, the pound and the Aussie. The greenback eked out the least gains versus the Japanese yen. Now, the strengthening of the US dollar and the Japanese yen, combined with the weakening of the risk-linked Aussie, suggests that markets turned to risk-off at some point yesterday and today in Asia. The Kiwi's rally points otherwise, but we already know that this was the result of the RBNZ decision overnight rather than the broader market sentiment. Looking at the performance in the equity world, we see that indeed sentiment was soft during the European trading and deteriorated even further during the US and Asian sessions, despite the S&P 500 and Nasdaq hitting fresh records in early trading. In our view, this was due to the US CPI accelerating by more than anticipated, with the headline rate rising to a 13-year high and the core one hitting its highest level since November 1991. This may have added to concerns that the inflation spike may eventually not be due to transitory factors and prompted market participants to bring forth their bets over when the Fed may start raising interest rates. Ahead of the CPI's expectations were for the committee to push the hike button in March 2023, but now such a move is nearly fully priced in for January 2023. Today, investors are likely to lock their gaze on Fed Chair Jerome Powell's testimony to Congress on the state of the US economy. They may be eager to find out whether their pricing is correct or not. Although we know from the latest dot plot that the consensus among officials is for rates to start rising in 2023, market participants may be looking for clues as to when this could happen as early as in January, as their bets suggest. Another point of interest may be any clues and hints on when policymakers are planning to start reducing their bond purchases. With the minutes emphasizing on a divided committee, Powell may provide more clarity on where the majority stands. In case we get remarks suggesting that this could happen in the next few months, the US dollar is likely to continue to drift north while equities may correct a bit lower. However, as we already noted yesterday and on Monday, stock market investors may also keep an eye on second quarter earnings, and thus we would treat any further decline in stock indices during Powell's speech as a corrective setback. Solid earnings may encourage participants to take advantage of any potential setback and push stock prices up again. Now, flying from the US to New Zealand overnight, we had an RBNZ monetary policy decision. The bank kept interest rates unchanged at 0.25%, and although we have been expecting an optimistic language, the statement was even more hawkish than what we and apparently many other market participants have been anticipating. Officials announced that they will end their large-scale asset purchase program from next week, which sent the Kiwi sharply higher, taking it to the first place on the performance table of the major currencies. Now, bearing in mind that expectations around the Fed's future plans may keep any future Kiwi gains limited against the US dollar, we prefer to exploit such gains against the Aussie. First of all, any impact due to the broader market sentiment will be offset, as both currencies are affected the same way. Second, last week, the RBA announced that it will proceed with more bond purchases beyond September, which could keep the Aussie in a more vulnerable position than the Kiwi. Long story short, we do expect Aussie Kiwi to continue drifting south for a while more. Later in the day, the central bank torch will be passed to the Bank of Canada. When they last met, policymakers of this bank kept their monetary policy settings unchanged, but noted that any adjustments to the pace of their quantitative easing purchases will be guided by the ongoing assessment of the strength and durability of the economic recovery. In our view, the absence of strong hints with regards to further tapering in the upcoming months may have disappointed some looming traders, and that's why the currency traded lower after the decision. However, since then, both the headline and core CPIs accelerated by more than anticipated, while the employment data showed that the Canadian economy added more jobs than expected in June. What's more important, though, is that the bank's latest business outlook survey indicator rose to a record high due to a fast vaccination pace and the easing of some COVID-related restrictions. In our view, this may allow the bank to scale back its quantitative easing further at this gathering, which combined with upbeat signals that more tapering is in the works for the months to come, could support the Canadian dollar. Again, we would choose as a counterpart the Aussie, which we expect to have a poorer performance due to a dovish RBA. As for the rest of today's events, during the early European session, we already got the UK CPIs for June. Both the headline and core rates rose more than expected, but the pound gained only somewhat, perhaps because at its latest gathering, the Bank of England insisted that the spike in inflation is likely to prove to be transitory, and added that they do not want to undermine the recovery by premature tightening. A few hours later, we have Eurozone's industrial production for May, while during the US session, the US PPIs for June are coming out. Eurozone's industrial production is expected to have weakened 0.1% month over month after improving 0.8% in April, while both the headline and core US PPI rates are expected to have risen further. On Thursday, during the Asian session, the main items on the agenda may be Australia's employment report for June, as well as China's GDP for the second quarter, which will be accompanied by the fixed asset investment, industrial production and retail sales of all for June. In Australia, the unemployment rate is forecast to have ticked down to 5% from 5.1%, but the net change in employment is expected to show that the economy has gained less jobs than in May. Specifically, it is expected to show a 30,000 jobs gain following a 115.2 new jobs in May. With the RBA still wearing its dovish dress, we don't believe that the anticipated slide in the unemployment rate will be enough to spark speculation that Australian policymakers will turn in the direction of the more hawkish Fed, RBA and Bank of Canada in the months to come, especially with the employment growth slowing down. As for the Chinese data, the GDP is expected to have accelerated to 1.3% quarter over quarter from 0.6%, while fixed asset investment is anticipated to have slowed to 12.5% from 15.4%. Industrial production and retail sales are expected to have slowed as well to 7.9% and 11% from 8.8% and 12.4% respectively. In our view, despite expectations of some slowdown during the last month of the quarter, it seems that the world's second largest economy has performed very well during the whole period, and thus we don't expect this data series to have a major impact on investors' morale. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm hosting every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.